the economic sociology of drug markets. This is, in my perception, a unique take on the study of drug markets that wasn't originally my idea, but was proposed by my co-author, Sveinung Sandberg, who's a professor of sociology at the University of Oslo. He had a number of interviews with higher-level drug distributors from Norwegian prisons and suggested that we write something together and utilize this economic sociological perspective. This is about 7 years ago. I'd never heard of this since my background is in criminology and secondarily public administration. But when once I started reading into it, I figured out that he was really onto something here. This could actually be the missing piece of the puzzle to be a bit dramatic, but this is my lecture, so I'm allowed to do that. Let me tell you a little bit about how I believe this perspective contributes to the research and why studying illicit drug markets is an interesting area. So I would say for criminologists, it's pretty obvious that drug markets are interesting. But since this is for the political science department, maybe tell a little bit more about why should this interest you? So, firstly, because it's a form of criminality that no state has ever stopped. So the main forms of illegal drugs like cocaine and heroin and cannabis were criminalized more than 100 years ago. And almost all of the countries in the world agree that these are illegal products. Simplified, but certainly yes. So this is interesting because it's a challenge to state authority. So it's illegal, but everywhere it still goes on. But it goes on in quite different ways. In North America, in the U.S. in particular, these markets are extremely violent. People are shot and killed in the metropolitan areas, but we don't really see that problem elsewhere in the world. So it's very different how these markets are shaped in different countries in the world. And this is, of course, a reflection of the policies to control them. So it's very interesting in itself, what kinds of criminal problems do we have? Secondarily, there are public health issues. So using any kind of psychoactive drug is unhealthy and addictive in some sense. So here with the illegal drugs, criminals make them available to young people and to people that have problems with being addicted to them. They're ruining their health and sometimes even their lives. And a problem in this problem is that the quality of these drugs is totally unregulated. As criminals will adulterate the drugs with all kinds of harmful substances. Most notoriously, we're seeing the current opioid crisis in North America, where they have unprecedented rates of fatal intoxications. That so many people are dying from fentanyl overdoses that the life expectancy has fallen over the past 5 years. Finally, the monetary value of these markets is what initially interested me enough to write a PhD on the cannabis market in Copenhagen some 10-15 years ago. And that this monetary value attracts organized criminals, it attracts street gangs, anyone willing to run enough of a physical and legal risk to earn some money can be involved. And from this comes, of course, also the violence in some countries more than others, but everywhere we do see the violence. In the Scandinavian countries, this violence is worsening. We've seen an increase in the number of homicides and attempted homicides. And maybe more importantly, we've seen a different type of homicides become more predominant. So this is no longer primarily domestic violence, or maybe less, but the share of these homicides that is between young men in public areas that police never solve is steadily increasing. And of course, it's speculated that these homicides have to do with the illegal market for drugs. So, of course, there are many other forms of illegal markets. Some countries, like Sweden, have criminalized prostitution, so that's an illegal market. There are illegal markets for counterfeit cigarettes and alcohol. But really, the list of these illegal markets is relatively short. Without a doubt, illegal drugs are the most valuable commodity on that list. So barring tax fraud and these other forms of financial crime, illegal markets and illegal drug markets are the most important source of illegitimate income for organized criminals. So it is it's an interesting area of study. Now I've said markets many times already. So usually a market is something that we associate with the legal economy. So illicit drugs, this is something that is argued. Are these even markets? So in my opinion, yes, these are clearly markets. So they're not perfect markets organized by supply and demand, by this stereotypical economic man that has a perfect information and only makes decisions based on the price of the product. So this is a market in a broad sense, where exchange of goods for money under competition. And a little more nuanced, the definition would say that there can be levels of marketness, where the neoclassic conception of the perfect market is very high on marketness. Something like illegal drug markets are relatively low on marketness. How important is the price consideration? If it's very important, they're high on marketness. If it's less important, then low on marketness. Importantly, for illegal drug markets, there are no state institutions that regulate quality standards, ensure that people respect their competitors, and enforce contracts in a rule of law. So this is, of course, the complete opposite. The state is trying to stop these drug distributors and sanction them with heavy prison sentences. So for drug distributors to make this economy work, they have to figure out ways to trust each other and to reduce this uncertainty that is associated with the unknown quality of the products. So drug markets have been researched since at least the 1960s, when the first some street-level heroin markets became a big problem in the metropolitan areas of the U.S. But what we see, what I think we see in the social science research is the different types of questions. So economists will try and formalize the market in an equation, so at a very abstract level. Conversely, criminologists coming from a background in anthropology and sociology would typically have focused on this in the street level markets, as a street level heroin markets or cannabis markets or whatever it is. And of course, what you see here at the street level is not the economically rational behavior. This is the people of low socioeconomic status that may be addicted to drugs. They're not maximizing in every single transaction. They have a much more chaotic lives. These are not perfectly rational individuals. So this has spurred a bit of a conflict, where criminologists tend to be very critical of this economic perception of how these markets work. And this is not even just criminologists, this is sociologists working on legal economic issues as well. They tend to be very dismissive of the economists, and a little too dismissive for my tastes, because what the economists actually have been doing here with risks and prices, represented the paper by Avarda and Kleiman back from the 80s, wasn't this neoclassic economics. They do not assume an economic man with perfect information. They do not assume a perfect market. Rather, this is a form of behavioral economics that's, that considers things like organizational structure and bounded rationality and repeated transactions in a game theoretical form. I don't have an interest in ripping you off, because then we won't be able to make more deals. So I think often the criminological critique of the economist is unfounded. There are economists working on this that have an approach that is closer to sociology than the neoclassic economics that is often the target of sociological ridicule. So some sociologists that were early on to apply a more economic sociological perspective were Beckett and Wienger, that had an article from 2013 called In the Shadows, where they approached this transaction cost economic perspective and say that participants in the illegal market have problems with uncertainty that concerns the price and quality of the product, how to cooperate without being arrested by police, and how to deal with competitors without shooting everyone that is not in the same gang as you, because that quickly becomes a problem onto its own, because police are more interested in dead bodies than they are in a little weed. So they promoted this theoretical perspective that puts more emphasis on trust than the transaction cost economic perspective. Says that these are social networks, and these are individuals embedded in a social network, and that's how they make it work without being arrested and without the market collapsing due to all this uncertainty that follows from the illegality of the product. So economic sociology in itself is nothing new. So even all of the classic sociologists, Weber, Durkheim, and Karl Marx had writings on economics there, and said, so economics is too important to be left to the economists. I think probably Max Weber is the one that had the most interesting things to say about it. But since then, other sociologists have picked up on this tradition and continued in a new economic sociology, where Mark Conover is perhaps most well known, but also someone like Pierre Bourdieu has written extensively on the economic system. Broadly speaking, there are three perspectives or traditions within economic sociology that focuses either on institutions, social networks, or the cultural aspects. My research is mostly in the network and the institutional perspectives, but of course, state institutions and how they work is heavily affected by culture. So indirectly, that is included. And the subculture has also been included in some of the articles I have written with Sveinung Sandberg, because that's more of his area of expertise. Heath Copes has entered the waiting room. Great. So the institutional perspective deals with the state-devised regulation of markets. So in the legal economy of the state, has a lot of guarantees. That if you cheat, if you don't repay your credits, if you defraud your customers by selling something that doesn't live up to certain quality standards, they will take you to court. They will tax your business. They will have detailed standards for for your accounting practices, etc., etc., etc. The state is heavily involved in the economy. As I mentioned, this is the opposite for drug dealers, because they want to avoid the state at all costs. But what we find actually is that they mimic a number of these state regulations in informal ways. They adapt to the state control by operating in the darkness, in covert networks, and they learn how to cooperate with their partners and build some trust, especially at the higher distribution levels. The street level might be different, might be closer to this this perception of the black markets where they continuously rip each other off. But this is not really a viable strategy at the higher levels, where each transaction is a lot more valuable. People will be more likely to shoot you if you rip them off for a large sum of money than a very small sum of money. So the research I've done in this area concerns the specificities of these state-devised rules, as different countries have different drug control policies. How heavy are the sanctions for these various offenses? What strategies do police use? How many police resources do we want to spend on controlling the drug markets? And what are our goals with this control? So here I've examined some temporal trends and with a focus on sanction certainty, where I think a lot of research on drug policy, drug control policy, is focused on changes to sanction severity. But this is a criminological perspective. This is a deterrence perspective. Sanction certainty is much more important. It's the chance of getting caught that will make you reduce your criminal offending, rather than the heaviness of the sanction should you eventually be caught. The other perspective that I worked within is this network perspective. So this is about how these dealers learn to trust one another, despite this temptation to always rip each other off and steal from each other. Because why wouldn't you do that? The state is not going to mind that you steal a load of drugs from another criminal. The other criminal might mind and will shoot you, but that's not a good way of conducting business. So they have to learn how to cooperate without continuously ripping each other off. And this is an area where the economic sociological perspective really contributes to the economic analysis, because this is trust is not something that preoccupies economists a lot. This is a very sociological concept. You can't really put it in a formula. So the economists are not too interested in this aspect of it, except for there's some game theoretical conceptualization, but that gets a little technical for me. So here, the research I've done is how do they trust each other? How do they reduce uncertainty with regards to the price, with regards to the quality of the drugs? So that was my introduction to the economic sociological framework that is guiding my research. For the rest of the talk, I'll tell you about some studies I have done applying this framework to a number of case studies, but also to give you an impression of what kind of researcher am I. So when I say I research drug markets, that's the common denominator for the studies I have done. But as you can see here, the topics and especially the data is quite varied, if I may say so myself. As this is both qualitative interviews and some quantitative analysis from both official sources, but also from online sources. So the first half is offline, and the second half is the online drug market. So basically whatever I can get my hands off that I can use to elucidate aspects of the illegal drug markets is what I've been doing. This also explains my recent interest in the online trade, because this is really a new opportunity for us to actually see what is going on in these markets. So crime statistics and surveys and qualitative interviews, that's all nice and well, but it's not a very direct representation of what's going on. But we have something closer to that with the online data. So enforcement intensity. So how many resources do police use when compared to what? So in this line of research, I've tried to do some descriptions of the illegal drug markets that answer some of these questions about how much crime is actually going on. So what is the number of offenses that occur within these markets? And the police statistics are not going to inform us too well on this. They will inform us on how much is the police doing, how much of a priority is this for police, what level are they prioritizing, as the higher levels or the street level. But this classical criminological problem, this doesn't really tell us too much about what is actually going on. So what we see here on the left is an aerial photo of a open air cannabis market in Copenhagen, known as Christiania or Pusher Street, as it were. This is from 15 years ago, just before a large police crackdown on the market, where they gathered criminal evidence to use in the courts to have the sellers convicted. And I was fortunate enough to get access to this material. And which is a better representation than how much cannabis do people buy at a time? What is a typical transaction? When in the day does this take place? Does it follow other typical crime patterns? Is there more drug trades on warmer days and less on days when it's raining? So yes and yes. And about $20 per transaction. So this is, I was very happy to do this because the data here is quite unique, and it really shows a picture of a routine activity marketplace. This is really how we would expect as a regular, normal legal market to function, because at the time it almost was. So this is something, okay, clearly this is a market for cannabis. These are two other studies on enforcement intensity and problem pressure. So to your left is an indexed number of reported drug offenses in Denmark. So the important thing is the law on euphoria-inducing substances, which is the minor drug offenses, which have almost doubled for the past 20 years. So this is something that people will typically say, okay, so Danish drug policy has gone from being quite lenient on cannabis and drug users to being repressive is the term that they will use, because we see a doubling in the number of cases. Well, I think the most interesting thing for me here is, yes, we do see this, but this is also following a period of time in the late 1990s when drug use increased markedly in all Western countries, not only Denmark, where it was already pretty high, but in all Western countries, including Sweden, So this of course means that the value of the market, monetary value, increased as well, which gave a renewed interest to gangs to participate in the trade. But it also puts this police effort into context. So this is not politicians and police that suddenly have an anti-drug stance. we're leaving out the part of the story that they're actually responding to an increased problem pressure is what I would refer to it as. On the right-hand side of the screen, this is a comparison of this control intensity between the four Nordic countries, Denmark, Finland, Norway, and Sweden, where all of the countries experienced this increase in cannabis prevalence, and that I argue that so really the number of police drug seizures should be seen in relation to this drug using population, and that this shifts the traditional picture of how restrictive the Nordic countries are on this issue. Skipping ahead to the next topic, so the credit under illegality. So I'm talking a little more than I expected to. I mean, so credit under illegality is another good illustration of the relevance of this economic sociological perspective. This because Peter Reuter, that was one of the proponents of this risk and prices framework, actually addresses this in his book, This Organized Crime, that credits shouldn't really take place in illegal markets because why would anyone pay more for the drugs on credit as a higher per gram price? And what would prevent them from just taking off with the drugs, absconding with the product instead of actually repaying their debts? These are classical issues in economics, and the economic analysis really suggests that it's difficult to see this happening in drug markets. There's adverse selection among the debtors. It's the poorest, most unreliable people that will pay the higher credit price. But when Sveinung and his student research assistants interviewed higher-level drug dealers in Norwegian prison, they talked a lot about using credits and how important credits were to running their business. Because you don't want to be the drug distributor that gets stuck with a kilo of cocaine. You want to get that kilo of cocaine away from you as fast as possible, and then people can come give you the money, because it's the kilo of cocaine that's going to get you a long prison sentence. So get rid of the inventory, and then we can worry about getting the money later. And if you're a good businessman, people like you, or you're trusted, they will, for the most part, give you your money back. So we see some different interpretations of why and how this works, where they would agree that just increase the credit price, make it a little more expensive, just as you would see in the legal economy. But most importantly, it's a way of building trust. So you, by giving someone credit, you actively demonstrate that you trust them. So even if you don't trust them, by pretending that you trust them, you are actually building this trust. And if this works and they actually come back with the money, you have a potential future partner to work with here. So this illustrated how not only does credit take place in illicit higher levels of drug distribution, it's actually a really important part of making this whole drug market work. Moving on to the online drug distribution, which I've had the fortune of working on for the past couple of years, especially with Rasmus Munchsgaard that I heard was joining us today. And you'll see some of the graphics that I'll be using in the next couple of slides. He has made those, and I'm sure he'll be defending his thesis on crypto markets in about a month's time. So have a follow him on Twitter if you find any of this interesting. So this two studies, fentanyl sales on Kiernet web shops, and comparing prices on crypto markets with some street level prices collected by police. So fentanyl sale, it's a long story. Fentanyl is a brand name for one particular form of synthetic opioid that's used in extreme pain treatment in hospitals and palliative care, as people that are dying in severe pain, they get it. But it is also used by drug users, gives a euphoria and a feeling. And as I mentioned, it has been used in North America to contaminate the heroin supply. And this is quite a new phenomenon. This is within maybe the past 5 years. It's been seen before in the 80s and 90s, but these were very limited outbreaks. For the past years, it has really flooded the heroin market, at least on the West Coast and also the East Coast, where it appears that these Mexican cartels that are supplying the American heroin market have started just mixing it in with the heroin, because then you can have a very potent product for it's much easier to produce, and it's much easier to conceal and smuggle across borders. So it's, from a drug distributor perspective, it's really a great product. From the drug users, not so much. It can be 50 to 100 times stronger than the heroin, and you can't really tell beforehand how strong the heroin that you think you're buying actually is. So people are dying in hordes. The same thing happened in Sweden. We saw a lot of overdoses, a lot is a sort of 40, 50 overdoses a year from fentanyl, but this is a lot compared to in a country of 10 million people. So interestingly, fentanyl is not illegal in Sweden, or rather fentanyl itself is, but fentanyl analogs as a slightly altered chemical variants of fentanyl are not illegal. So it's only illegal if the Swedish health authorities and the government have said that this particular analog is too dangerous and illegal. If it is not illegal, it is actually legal. So this allowed for a fentanyl market to exist in Sweden, where these users took to most of them probably users, some of them all just like me, interested in this, took to the public web forum flashback.org and started discussing these different analogs that they could buy on the web shops. The problem was that nobody knows what this new analog does. So this is not pharmaceutical fentanyl. This is produced somewhere in China or India, and then smuggled to Sweden and sold. Nobody knows what is the correct concentration, what is the correct dose. They sold them as monkey water, as a nasal sprays, and as a watery solution, or as pills. So on these web forums, they're discussing how expensive should these nasal sprays be. How good is this new analog? Because whenever one analog was criminalized, oops, there would be a new one on the market. But was it as good for a psychoactive substance as the previous one? How much should it cost? And a lot of discussion on prices and qualities, as the valuation of these products. So this of course also speaks to the market for these drugs. So lots of interesting stuff in these posts. We did a qualitative analysis that's recently been published in the Journal of Drug Issues, where one interesting aspect is that the owners of these web shops, which there were perhaps a handful of, would participate in the discussions, as they would communicate directly to the customers on these web forums. And so when people say they felt ripped off, they will go there, oh, okay, no worries, you'll get your money back. So some of your money back, or you will get a rebate on your next purchase. And now we have figured out the right price. So they would negotiate with the users, which is interesting from this economic sociological standpoint, because the buyers are not only going to the best price and the best product, as we would expect from an economic analysis. They're actively negotiating with these web shop owners, who have an interest in being trustworthy as a suppliers. So they can't just ignore these complaints. They actually have to engage with the buyers and offer them economic compensation. So the market as a whole, this is one of the graphics by Rasmus Munksgaard that I mentioned. You can see here at the bottom of the screen. It began in late 2012 and continued until late 2019. So at the top left, you see a couture, and then moving down, V15, S2. So these are the names, the common or short names of all these different fentanyl analogs that were offered on the web shops. The dots on the in the figure are posts on this flashback forum, and this figure in shows the development of the marketplace over this period of time, where people are discussing individual analogs and several analogs at a time. But when they're made illegal, when they're scheduled as narcotics by the Swedish state, you can see the red dots, interest decreases and discussions move on to another analog. So, of course, this interest could also be negative interest. We see some of the most intensely debated ones are acetyl and acryl, which were also the ones that were responsible for a lot of fatal overdoses. So that's we haven't gotten to that yet. Is it actually a positive discussion? But here we see how interest decreases once they're criminalized. Lastly, study on quantity discounts on crypto markets and Facebook. This is a study with Rasmus Munksgaard and Jakob Demand in Denmark, that Jakob collected, had his PhD student collect data from Facebook, where people are advertising for drugs in Sweden. So this is comparing the crypto markets with the open social media sales. So the idea here is that, in an economic analysis, we would expect the crypto market prices to be lower, since they have less of a risk of police intervention. But in practice, we actually see that the price levels are kind of similar. To the extent that we can say anything about prices, because we don't know what quality of the drugs they're selling. But so this is the economic sociological connection is not super strong here. Rather, this is something that points forward as to what kind of risks, what kind of economic compensation do sellers on social media and crypto markets see for themselves. As they're not running the risks as someone standing on a street corner, but they need compensation for other aspects of their work. What exactly is it? Or maybe it is just a lot more profitable to sell drugs in this way. So it's something we'd like to look at closer in the years to come. And finally, the last slide here, we have some price comparisons for herbal cannabis, hash, and cocaine on the crypto market, social media, and law enforcement. And this is really my attempt at coming full circle with the discussion of these data sources for studying illicit drug markets, because historically, most of what we have is estimates from law enforcement, as from police going out on the street and pretending to be drug buyers and seeing what price they can get. And so this police are not your typical buyer. Maybe they haven't got the relationship. They haven't built up the trust. When they say a kilo costs this, is this because they're actually getting ripped off by the dark distributor because he doesn't expect to do more business with them? Or is it actually a similar price as to what an actual drug distributor would get. So you see the price levels are similar, and interpret this as it's a path forward for studying illicit drug markets using this online data, because most countries don't have as good law enforcement price data as the Swedes do. They have quite good law enforcement estimates in the US, but very few other countries are as privileged in this regard. And for these countries, yeah, I mean, maybe use crypto markets, maybe use social media data. This data is available for researchers, and certainly has reinvigorated the field of drug market research in the past couple of years. And that will be it for me. Thank you for your attention. You're very welcome to email me, and I'll send you some of these articles if you should be interested. Or just follow me on Twitter, where I am not very active, but I will post it if I have a new paper or whatever. So, yeah, thanks.